Okay, good morning everyone, and welcome to Forum Kerja Pembangunan Seminar. This is the last series of seminar hosted by Smeru. Today we will have our director, Bapak Dr. Asep Suryadi, who will present his research on evaluating Indonesia unconditional cash transfer program. So we will have 45 minutes of presentations, and until lunch time we will have questions and answers. So Asep, please.
Thank you, Abby. Maybe I'll stand up a little bit here. Thank you again, everybody, for coming here. Here I would like to share our study on evaluating the impact of the DLT program, Unconditional Cash Transfer, which were implemented in 2005 and 2006. So we did not include the one implemented in 2008-2009. Before moving on, I would like to say three things about this study. First, this is a joint paper with Ken Bailey from UC San Diego and Pak Sudarno from Smeru and FP2AKA. Secondly, the funding for this study we got from a competitive research grant from 3IE, the International Initiative on Impact Evaluation. Thirdly, because this is still an ongoing study, meaning we don't have a final report yet, so we have to treat all the findings that I will present today as preliminary. Okay. I will divide my presentation into four parts. After a short introduction, I will explain a little bit about the program background, context, and data. Then I will spend most of my time on the empirical methods and results. After that, I will end little bit with a conclusion with policy implications and the way forward. So let's start with the introduction. Just to refresh your memory, I'm sure you already know all about this, but since this has been passing through quite some time, maybe it's beneficial for us to refresh our memory, go back to 2005. 7 years ago. At that time, the international price of oil escalating very rapidly. And as the response, the government at the time slashed its subsidies on fuel and consequently raising the prices of domestic fuel by an average of 140% in September, actually October, the 1st of October 2005. And this reduction in subsidy resulted in about $10 billion in budgetary saving, of which $2 billion were allocated to a large-scale unconditional cash transfer program, popularly known as the BLT, the Bantuan Langsung Tunai. This BLT program basically provided recipient household with around $30, 300,000 rupiah per quarter, and the purpose of this program was to prevent poor household and near poor household from having to reduce expenditure on essential commodities, also on health and education because of the inflationary pressure from increasing fuel price. To our knowledge, this program, although it is a very large in scale, has never been rigorously evaluated its impact. We here at Smeru have conducted a few studies on this program, but they are qualitative studies looking at the process as well as beneficiary assessment. So we try to complement the studies with the rigorous quantitative impact evaluation in this study. And we will look at its impact on household expenditure, work hour, and education outcomes. So let's move on to the program background, context, and data. Again, in the 1st of October 2005, the government raised the price of kerosene, minyak tanah, by 186%, gasoline by 88%, and diesel by 105%. Diesel, automotive diesel, solar. When we try to analyze the 2004 data, a year before the increase in the price, we found that more than 95% of Indonesian households consume at least one of these three main fuel products, and the majority, more than 90%, consume kerosene at the time. In the next slide, we will see that the automatic diesel, solar, and the gasoline premium, the subsidies for these commodities are regressive, while the current kerosene consumption tends to be relatively flat across the distribution of income. We can see that from this figure, this is for kerosene, the black graphic. We see that although it's still increasing, it's not very steep yet, right, compared to gasoline and diesel. We can see from here that the consumptions of gasoline and diesel, more than 35% are consumed by the 10 richest population. If we join that with the 9th decile, meaning the 20% richest population, they consume about half of the gasoline and diesel. So it's very, very regressive subsidies. Meaning these are subsidies which are consumed half by the 20% of this population. However, this fuel product comprises only a small share of household expenditures on average. Yeah, on average. For example, using the 2004 data, we found that the poorest decile only allocate less than 1% of their budget on fuel, while the richest decile, the richest 10%, only spend less than 2% of their household budget on fuel. But the indirect impact of this subsidy removal is that what is here, because they only not only affect the transportation cost, but we also affect indirectly on production. Cost of production of goods. Now about the program. This UECT program, the target for this program was collected through a poverty census called PSEOI by GPS, which involved local officials. And the program was intended to reach all poor and near poor households. It's basically around below the around 1.2 times of the poverty line. But in reality, many of non-poor households receive the program, and on the other hand, many poor and near poor households were excluded from benefiting from the program. The recipient receives a certificate that shows that they are eligible to receive the benefit to the benefit of this job. And then they retrieve the cash transfer quarterly through the post office. So they went to the post office. You will see the figure of this later. And when we calculate it with the 2005 data, the full transfer amount, it's approximately half of the baseline median monthly household expenditure among the recipients. So it's relatively sizable transfer. And from qualitative studies, we found that local officials in some areas were succeeded in extracting a portion of the cash transfer for their organic waste or for redistribution for non-recipients. So this is basically the process. A recipient received a card or a certificate which has four coupons in it. There are four coupons, one coupon for each quarter. And then each quarter they will go to the post office to collect the money, and they present this certificate and the coupon to most cases with ID card, the KTP, and in the end, they get the money. That's the whole process of the program. You see that the coupon here has disappeared for the first quarter and changed into the money. So what you want to do is to analyze what the impact of those programs, giving money to poor and near poor households. And to do that, we use data from Susanas panel 2005-2007. Each year, the data was collected in the month of February. And we will see later that the February 2005 Susanas data provides a good baseline for impact evaluation because it is implemented before the program. So we'll see it from the next slide here. So the increase in the fuel price is in October 2005 here, which we can see its impact on inflation. This is the general inflation. The solid black line is the general inflation, and the dashed line is the inflation for transport and communications. The Susunas 2005 was filled in February 2005. So way below before this, so this is provide a good baseline. Then we have a second Susanas in February 2006, which is around here, after the program runs for the first quarter and entering the second quarter. Finally, the third Susanas in 2007 was implemented in February 2007, way after the program finished, and inflation has resumed to its normal course, yeah, by February 2007. So I think this is a good data coincidentally that we have that we can use to evaluate this program. So from these three Susanas, 2005, 2006, and 2007, we form two panel data. One is a panel data for 2005-2006, which consists of more than 9,000 households, and we found that there are more than 2,400 households which receive UCT. Then when we add the third data, the 2007 data, we have a three-year panel. The panel observation dropped to 7,000 households because of some attrition, and we still have about 1,700 households with UCT. So we will use these two panels, two-year and three-year panels, in our analysis. In the two-year panel, of the 2,400 recipients, one-third, around 600 of them, have only received one single payment by February 2006, while the rest two-thirds, the rest 1,800 households, have already received two tranches of payment at the time. There is one shortcoming of the data. In the poverty census EAT05, BTS uses 14 eligibility indicators to assess households whether they are eligible or not to receive this program. But in the Susan asked 2005 data, we only have 8 of these 14 eligibility indicators. So we cannot use the full eligibility indicators to assess the beneficiaries and the impact of the program. So we have seen this. Now let's see how the targeting of this program in reality. We found that indeed, on average, recipient household poorer than non-recipients in early 2005 before the program was implemented. You can see from this slide that the expenditure per capita of the control, meaning the household which did not receive the program, was about 315,000 rupiah per month per capita, while for those who receive it's about 180,000. And we found, for example, there are only 10% of the control household who live below the poverty line, while the recipients also around 25%. However, we also found that there is a quite large leakage in this program, as 30% of the recipients were in the top 6 per capita expenditure decile, while under top rate is also like at half of the lowest student decile did not receive any benefits. You can see that from this graph. So when we divide household into 10 groups, this is the 10% poorest household and this is the 10% richest household. We see that, and this is the solid black bar is the 2-time recipient, while this one is the 1-time recipient, and this is non-recipient, the gray one is the non-recipient. You see that for the two lowest decile in the 20% poorest household, it's only about half of them received the TLP, and the other half did not receive any TLP. And if we accumulate this from the 5th decile to the 10th decile, the recipients are quite significant also. They are constituted about 37%, so almost 40% of all the recipients are in this decile. So that's not a good feature of the program, but for researchers like us, that's good because that gives us opportunity to assess the impact. Because the overlap makes it possible for us to create credible identification. Because we can compare the poor who received ELP and the poor who did not receive ELP and what the impact on them. If the targeting is imperfect, we cannot do this study. Because all the pool will receive ELP, and those who don't receive ELP are the non-pool. And so this study will be impossible. And we can see also that from this figure, you see that some of the recipients are indeed very poor. This lady must be from the category of chronic poor, yeah? She cannot even move, yeah? So she has to be also to retrieve the money. Well, this gentleman, we see he used a jacket because he came with a motorcycle to the post office. So we can see that indeed the recipients are from diverse groups, not only from the group. Okay, now how we do the impact evaluation? That's the typical part. My apology for all the questions, but I will try to explain that in a simple way. Basically, what we want to estimate here is the treatment effect on the treated this is, your teacher is not training of trainers, but treatment effects on the treated. Meaning that what's the impact of the program on those who receive the benefit. And the specification is quite simple. This third year represents the growth in household expenditure, whether it is affected or not with, by the household receiving the DRP program or not. That's just very simple understanding of this equation. So if the household receives the DRP, the value of this variable is 1, otherwise it will be 0. Since this program is not distributed randomly, then we cannot estimate this equation using OKRS, using the ordinary square, because that would be biased. So ideally, we have to estimate this equation using regression discontinuity. However, because we only have 8 of the 14 eligibility indicators, we cannot implement this regression discontinuity either. So we have to forget about this most ideal method of evaluating the impact of this program. So we have to resort to other alternatives. The first one is the most conventional method using different indifference with matching or weighting, which can yield Poisson effect. That's the first method that we will use. Also, we try to utilize the fact that the program, how the program is implemented to calculate its impact. The first one, remember that in the 2 year panel, we only have 1/3 of the recipient. We have 1/3 of the recipient have only received one tranche of payment, while 2/3 of the recipient have only received 2 tranches of payment. So we use that also to see whether there is any effect, any difference between the 2 times and 1 time recipient. Secondly, because the benefit is distributed to household, no matter how large or how small the household, it means that the transfer per capita will be different across households. So we also try to see the impacts of different per capita transfer on various indicators. So we will have 3 methods here. One, difference is different. Second, multivariate treatment, comparing the 2-time and 1-time disbursement. And the intensity of treatment, looking at the per capita transfer. Let's start with the difference in treatment. The difference in treatment matching or weighting estimator, it will allow unobserved time invariant determinants to differ systematically in the data. And this is the general matching estimator. It basically says that the estimator here is the difference, the weighted difference between the recipient here and the non-recipients, but only the recipient who are similar to the recipient. So not all non-recipients are included here. If they are rich, for example, they will not be here. So we always select households which are similar to the recipient. That's the matching estimator. A recent update on this method is to use general weighting estimator via weighted least square. It basically is the same. This is the recipient, the consumption growth of the recipient, and this is the all non-recipient, but they are weighted in accordance to their probability of receiving the program, the inverse of it, so that they are become similar to it. So in principle, these two estimators are same. Basically, comparing those households which receive the benefit from the program with comparable household which did not receive the program. So that's the understanding of the two equation. And according to a new study by Russo in our equation that reweighting this estimator have a better sample properties in limited intervals. So we have several estimators, variants of the estimator. For reweighting, we have three different estimators. One is the inverse probability weighting, this is the simplest one. The secondly is the double robust, which is the same with this, added by either the probability score or the household characteristic as a control variable. And the counter function measure, which is the same as IDW, but adding the polynomial of the probability score and probability score interacted with the whether household is inferior or not. The more conventional method using ranking estimator, we use the nearest neighbor method. It's basically so control household which have the highest probability of receiving the program even though they actually did not receive the program. For the probability score to assess probability of household receiving the program, we use flexible logistic specification with all the underlying PMT score, the eight indicators that we have, plus full set of household characteristics, household demographics, participation in the in past social programs, land holdings, also profits. Unfortunately, we can, this model can only explain about 25% of in explaining the probability of the household whether they will be successful or not. Before going to finding, this is the propensity score result. For recipients and the top year and non-recipients. And this value here shows the probability of this household of receiving BLT. And using methods developed by Trump, this line to the left shows these are the sample that can be compared. So this recipient can be compared with this non-recipient, and that's what we will use in the analysis. And this the performance of the estimator in the weighting. So this is the treatment distribution of household expenditure per capita in 2005. This is the distribution like this, the solid black line, and the this line here is the control. As we see earlier, that the control is richer than the recipient. With reweighting, we can shift this distribution to the left. It's quite close now between the treatment and control. They become quite similar, but unfortunately, the difference is still statistically significant. It's about 10% difference in the mean. These two groups. But now the distribution is much balanced than the original data. So basically what we do is we compare the treatment in this solid black line with the related control, which is this line, this gray line. So not this black line, not the original, not this. And this is our first finding. The dependent variable here is the change in club household expenditure per capita between 2005 and 2006, because this has the short-term effect. So the short-term effect of GLJ we found as negative here, meaning that the recipient household experience a lower expenditure growth than comparable non-recipients by about 3 to 4%. So that put us finding. And this is basically the figure of, this is the same as this. Basically this shows that they're quite similar, but the control, the comparable control is still slightly to the right by 4%. Looking at the medium term between 2005 and 2007, we see that in most cases the significance disappears, so there's no more difference between recipients and non-recipients, except for some cases still the same, around 4% difference in negative, still negative 4%. So in the short term, GLJ recipients have lower expenditure growth. In the medium term, they are about the same with the control. And when we test this result with various heterogeneities, and we found it robust, meaning the result did not change, even when we change the definitions of per capita expenditure, for example, using children equal to 0.5 and 0.7. When we deplete the expenditure using CPI, when we use the non-food expenditure from the previous year, when we use alternative geographic fixed effects, when we control with pre-existing social programs, and when we use different measures at other moments from the outcome, we still have the same findings. Now let's move to the second method. We use the staggering of disbursement. The staggering of disbursement to and follow-up of prostitution. This is accident escalation in treatment intensity using timing. In this table, we test whether the difference in the timing, the one-time recipient and two-time recipient, it can be explained mostly from the difference in the region, not by household characteristics. Meaning that it is not related to household characteristics. Rather, it is the distributions of the program itself. We know that the DLT is distributed through post office. So the difference between one time and two time distribution is simply reflecting the timing of the when the post office in the local areas distributed the cash transfer. So it's good because that is not correlated with household characteristics. And in fact, the staggering also did not correlate with the district expenditure, with population, with infrastructure, even with distance to Jakarta or provincial city, also to other. So it's really exogenous distribution differences. And because of that, we can continue with this method. This is the same figure as before, only now we compare, we split the recipients into one time and two time. So the solid black one is the two time recipient, this is the one time. And this is the non-recipient. We see that the recipient, two time and one time, is already balanced even before we reweight. And this can also be seen from here. This is the same figure as before, the difference is 10%. And additional variable here indicating that they have this disbursement to or not, this affects any significant effect. So how we should estimate this this model? There are two alternatives. Why is we estimate this is actually the same model as before? Only now we add this variable indicating whether household receives the second disbursement or not. And our parameter of interest is to tahun to 1 year. And an alternative specification will be to change this from whether household receive or not VLT to whether or not household receive the first tranche of VLT, and then we recover to tawan from this estimated parameter. But we use this one because we get the 2001 directly from the result of estimation. So that's the point of this specification. And this is the finding. So our variable of interest is here, 2 to 1. So this reflects the difference in expenditure growth between recipients of two times recipient and one time recipient. And we see here that the impact is positive and significant. And the magnitude is about 7 to 8%. So what you can say from here is that in the short term, between 2005 and 2006,
yes,
the two-time BLT recipient had 7 to 8% higher expenditure growth than one-time recipient. That's what this table says. And when we look at the median term between 2005 and 2007, it's still positive, but now it's not significant anymore. So meaning after the program finished, long after the program finished in 2007, there's no more difference between households who receive the BLT earlier than those who receive the BLT later. I think that's the if we disaggregate the expenditure into food and non-food, we see that this is mostly driven by expenditure on food. So in the short term, food is significant. Even in the medium term, when the total is not significant anymore, the food expenditure is still significant. And if we disaggregate more the consumption item, we get some interesting findings. This is only for short term, 2005-2006. So we get the same 7 to 8% of the total higher expenditure growth for two-time recipient. And significant for food. And among food component, we see that this is not driven by rice, sugar, they are not significant, but they are driven by fish, meat, dairy, fruit, nuts, vegetables, prepared food. These are all goods, yeah. Meaning the poor who receive BLT spend more on this protein sources and vitamin sources.
They still get rusty, did they? Rusty, at the time. They still get rusty also at the same time.
Rusty? Yeah. We only control for all other social programs. But also we see here that the consumption of alcohol and tobacco also
increases. Great point.
And for non-food, there's no increase on education, health, housing, security, but increase in transport, communications. Perhaps this reflects the use of handphone more intensively, and also on appliances. That's how the household spend their money. Now let's move to the third method using the per capita expenditure. A kita. And for the two time recipients almost double 180,000 per kapita. So this is just some explanations about this variation. Yeah, basically it says that this variation is orthogonal to household size. Hence, it is possible to exploit this feature of the program. And this has also been used by other people to exploit grants to villages which have the same amount per village, but with different number of population, with different grants per capita. And for the model, actually, we use the same model as before. In the staggering model, but we add transfer per capita here, and we control for household size. We get that the maximum household size in the data is 13, so each of these we control for that. So we get the mass metric of transfer per capita, and we have the same treatment and control household, and we use the same reweight method and the properties for. And this is the finding. In terms of transfer per capita differences, we have too many zeros here. It's actually 100,000 from the 100,000. Basically, this table says that in every additional 100,000 per capita transfer is translated into 4 to 7% higher per capita growth in the short term. And we see that after we end this transfer per capita, the effect of staggering disappeared. It's not significant anymore, the tau 2. That also makes sense because what matters actually is how much you receive rather than whether you receive it once or twice. And if we disaggregate the total expenditure into food and non-food, we still have the same. And in fact, the growth on non-food expenditure is slightly higher than for the food expenditure. So households tend to spend more on non-food expenditure from higher transfer. That's all the impact on expenditure. Now let's explore some other impact indicator. One see on the property transition between 2005 and 2006. Remember that we had an increase in property from 2005 to 2006, from 15 to almost 17.7%.
What's due to the right? Rice price. Was due to the rice price.
We need to look into that here. Rather, we look at the how BLT contribute to the change in the poverty. Here we divide household into four groups. Chronic poor, meaning they are poor in both 2005 and 2006. Into poverty, they were not poor in 2005, but they become poor in 2006. Out of poverty, they were poor in 2005, but not poor in 2006, and never poor in both years. We see that the impact is here from transfer to capita. Again, this is have too many zeros, so behind it. We see that BLT transfer reduces the probability of household to become chronic poor by 9%. This is already in a great marginal effect, so we can interpret this as percent change. BLT reduces the probability of non-poor household to poor into become poor household. the non-poor household, we receive BLT, most likely will not become poor in the next year. And the never poor household also benefited from BLT because they increased the probability of never to buy 70%. However, households who were originally poor and received BLT did not have a significant impact of becoming non-poor. So, even though the poor is BLT, most likely they will still poor. That's what this focus is. Another indicator that we look at is our work hours. I think this is important because one of the criticism towards BLT is that BLT is not giving a good education to people. It will make people lazy and people will work less and things like that. But we did not find an evidence supporting that argument here. We see here, this is in the short term, between 2005 and 2006. The impact is positive, but not statistically significant. Meaning that households will receive BLT did not change their work hours. They maintain that their work hours.
How did you measure as work, Pastor? How did you measure as work? How did you measure as work?
Our work, that the variable in Susanas.
Oh, in Susanas, yeah. Just the last week, is it? The
previous last week, yes. Mm-hmm. This is the, in Susanas is the variable of work hours. In fact, in the major term, between 2005 and 2007, the impact is still positive and now becomes significant. We found that the two-time recipient worked about 2 hours more than the one-time recipient per week. Yeah. But again, if we look at using the transfer per capita, the impact again is not significant. So what we can say from here is simply that BLT seems to have no effect on workers. So people not become lazy because they that's what we can say from here. On health, at baseline, even before we meet, the recipient and numerous recipient actually already quite similar. And we found that UTT recipients have higher utilization of outpatient services by around 0.5 to 0.06 visit per person per month to health providers. Yeah. But this is only for short term. By the medium term, the effects already disappear. But the gain is the same to both private and public. So it seems that BLT increases modestly on utilization of healthcare services. Finally, we look at the education outcomes. Here we look at two indicators. One is probability of school dropout, and the other one is on child labor of students. Yeah. On the first one, in the sample, we have more than 18,000 children of school age, and only 29 of them drop out. And 4 of them are from UCT household. Although the numbers are very small from the sample, when we test it, it's still statistically significant that children from BLT recipient household are slightly more likely to drop out. But if we test it using the per capita transfer, we see that there is a moderating effect from larger transfer household. So it seems that important to consider per capita transfer not only per household. And by 2007, the effect was actually already disappeared because we already go back to the normal. On the second indicator, we have a strong impact of ECT on reducing child labor actually. But this is child labor only of children who are still in school. So we don't see the impact on children who are not in school. And the effect is about 0.2 to 0.5 work hours and 0.05 to 0.2 work day. So that's all the findings, the preliminary findings that we get from this study. We get to the final part of this presentation, the conclusion. I have shown you some of the tables, so I guess it will be useful to have a recap of what I have shown you so far. This is the summary of the findings of UPCC. The first one on household expenditure, we use three methods. The first one using binary treatment effect, and we compare short term and medium effect. For short term, we have a negative effect of 3-4% lower expenditure growth. In the medium term, there is no significant difference. Using multi-family treatment effect, the staggering, one and two recipients, two tranches, we see that the two time distribution have 7% higher expenditure growth than the one time. And again, it disappeared by the midterm. The third method is seeing treatment intensity. We found that every 100,000 rupiah higher capital transfer lead to 4-7% higher. In terms of poverty transition, we found that higher per capita transfer leads to reduced probability of household to become chronic poor and to fall into poverty, and higher probability to become never poor. But no significant impact on for poor household to move out of it. On hours worked, using multiple treatment effects, in the short term we found that no statistical difference, but in the medium term we found that two tracks disappears for 2 hours more per week than one track disappears. And using the treatment intensity effect, we found no effect on both hours. On health, we found that there's an increase in utilization of outpatient health services. And education, UCT is weakly associated with higher school dropout rate, but reducing labor supply of children. That's all the recap of all the findings. And what's next? Is it possible that this program will be used again? Because so far the government has used the UCT program twice. Yeah? Every time the government increased the fuel price, they will accompany it with a compensation program, among others with this program. Do we see any potential for this to repeat again in the future? It seems so, yeah. Because even though we know that fuel price subsidies are regressive, costly and inefficient, but they are pervasive in the public countries. So many countries subsidize fuel. But the level of subsidy in Indonesia is much higher compared to other countries. So this makes the potential gain from even partial reform is already high. This data is for 2008. We see several Asian countries here. Indonesia is here. The price of fuel is less than half dollar. I think Bangladesh and the Philippines, they use the market price, yeah, around $1.2 here. So maybe these countries, they tax fuel use, yeah. And other countries here subsidize them. But Indonesia is only beaten by Turkmenistan in subsidizing oil. So I guess
Turkmenistan is very much oil resources.
Oh, okay. Thank you. I don't know that.
But it's very corrupt.
Okay.
keep a figure of Singapore?
No, but I don't know.
More the same as Malaysia.
Oh, no, Singapore is more expensive than Malaysia. No?
Yeah.
Because Singaporeans like to go to Malaysia to buy
fuel.
Just cross the seas and then go back to pull back. So, okay, if you look at this figure, it seems that maybe reform will happen someday. We don't know when, but if you look at this figure, it seems inevitable. But what the findings of this study say, if again reform happens and UCD is it is, what we can say from the findings of this study is that there are several things that we need to reconsider in the implementations of this. I use a question mark here because we are not sure whether UCD will be used or not. The first thing is clear that targeting is a problem in the UCD in the past. Only half of the poorest 20% of population is used, while 40% of UCPs is coming from the rich households. So we need to improve the targeting, and maybe the answer is in the unified database for targeting, which has been developed by the NPS Watana. Maybe it's the answer of anyone. Another thing is that the size of renter seems to matter a lot, yeah, from our finding. Because the higher the per capita transfer, the better the impact on it. It seems so. So maybe we should reconsider keeping the city uniformly to all households despite of their size. Secondly, is the frequency of distribution seems also to matter. Because aside from our finding, which shows that there are significant differences between two-time and one-time recipients, for our qualitative study, we also found that most households spend the quarterly disbursement in less than 1 month. So what is supposed to last for 3 months is spent in less than 1 month. So maybe we have to reconsider the frequency of distribution from quarterly to monthly. All of here is question mark, meaning it's open for discussion. Finally, the last one on the impact on education, especially on labor and dropout. It seems that we have to consider this specifically as an additional component of PLP to household. If household have children in school, maybe we should have specific transfer for them. Because we see that that's moderating the impact on probability of dropout and enforcing the impact on the education. I think that's all what I can share with you today. I'm happy to discuss with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Bajan. So we open the questions. Maybe 3 questions. Mention your name and institution.
Can I say Indonesia? My airline is here. What is Indonesia? Terima kasih banyak sekalian. Mungkin ini saya akan menyampaikan masalah metodologi analisis yang cuma dari pengalaman kerja. Mungkin supaya apa namanya? Supaya analisis ini lebih tajam mungkin. Sesenas 2006 dengan 2007 itu kayaknya sampelnya bobotnya kan lebih banyak tersebar di Pulau Jawa dibanding di luar Jawa. Kalau kita lihat seperti itu di pengalaman di lapangan, kalau kita lihat sampel di luar Jawa juga yang kalau yang intersection antara yang kena sampel sesenas dengan yang kena DP juga kecil ya, nggak terlalu besar. Karena sampel kan PLT banyak sekali, berapa juta rumah tangga saya masih sudah juta hasil dari itu ya. Nah, sampel saya kan juga berapa puluh rumah tangga seluruh Indonesia, per kabupaten juga cuma berapa persen berapa rumah tangga. Sehingga sampelnya mungkin kalau mau ini lebih tajam mungkin kecil aja, Jawa dengan Bali. sepedai kenapa Jawa dan Madura sebenarnya ini besar, itu sudah kelihatan. Kemudian masalah yang mungkin perlu dilihat juga bahwa tadi adalah masalah desa dengan kota. Sampel di Susenas 2000 sekian itu biasanya juga lebih cenderung di kotanya itu adalah daerah-daerah pinggiran gitu ya, daerah pinggiran yang tentunya juga mirip-mirip dengan daerah desa. Nah ini kalau dipilah jadi desa kota mungkin juga gambarannya lebih tajam lagi gitu. Kalau memungkinkan. Kemudian yang ketiga, tapi masalah inflasi, kemudian masalah desa kota, kemudian masalah tapi saya lupa. Tapi tadi kita kesimpulannya di kesimpulan tadi ada yang menyampaikan, disampaikan bahwa masalah frekuensi di situ. Kalau kita lihat di lapangan, kita tanya pada rumah tangga yang kena sampo, apakah dapat BLT, dapat PAK. Kemudian Anda disampaikan dapat uangnya berapa? 3.000 Pak. Tapi kan nggak mungkin diambil setiap bulan karena banyak sekali kantor pos di kabupaten itu nggak ada, di kecamatan juga nggak ada. Jadi banyak kecamatan yang sebaliknya itu nggak ada kantor posnya, sehingga biaya untuk kantor pos cukup mahal ya kalau mereka beli kantor pos. Biasanya pihak desa itu minta tolong pada pihak desa untuk mengambilkan gitu, dan itu mereka diambil kita bisa sampai 150.000 sampai 200.000. Kenapa? Kalau ini katakanlah nanti berlanjut bermasalah juga karena biaya untuk pergi ke kecamatan atau pos itu cukup mahal, apalagi kalau daerah kepulauan ini. Dan tentunya tidak semua kecamatan ada kantor pos. Kemudian masalah tadi untuk rumah tangga yang miskin, saya kira di lapangan di daerah pedesaan di luar Jawa mereka sangat membantu untuk sekolah. Kemudian yang masalah drop out karena keluarga miskin di luar Jawa yang tidak sekolah bukan karena dia tidak mau sekolah, tapi karena tempat sekolahnya itu jauh dan tentunya juga kalau pas ombak tinggi mereka nggak bisa sampai ke sekolahan. Jadi ada beberapa hal yang mungkin harus dicermati juga sih kalau mau dipilah Jawa mungkin lebih fit. Saya kira itu. Terima kasih.
Thank you. My name is Rizal. I have some questions myself. One question actually overlap with the first question. The first question will be about the attrition of the sample under the Susenas 2005-2007. It's very nice that the attrition on the first disbursement and the second disbursement is not correlated with the household characteristics, but how about the attrition on the sample itself? Because I think here there you only have 1,700 something sample out of 2,400 against the 700 something for the sample attritions. Is there any correlation? Is there any way of take you away from the from the regression or anything? Because I think you only wait on the propensity of being treated. And second, the CPI that you mentioned, I think it's probably a good idea if you also display using the public CPI. Probably the World Bank can share the CPI for the poor. And the third one will be, this is actually one overlap with the first question. This is about the Java and non-Java. Because I'm interested in the effect of a PKH actually, and from a randomized control trials by the World Bank and BAPENAS studies, they also show that the effect of transfers. This one is conditional class transfers. It's not really significant for education, but the problem is the randomized control trials was only for Western provinces. And my question is there a way that you can, also exploit the eastern provinces? I think that's
my first time attending this forum. This is very good, and I would also like to congratulate Asep for your excellent presentation. I have two questions related to the presentation.
And is your name, sir?
Yeah. My name is Rendra from Papernas, Director of Social Protection and Welfare. Yeah, I just want to ask two questions, and I would like to share one additional information, but please allow me to speak in Bahasa just to speed up my yang pertama, Pak, saya ingin tahu bagaimana dalam penelitian yang Bapak kerjakan ini, bagaimana cara Bapak mengisolasi dari program-program lingkungan sosial lainnya. Seperti kita ketahui pada tahun 2005, waktu itu kita ada setelah JPS kan mungkin baru awal-awal kita luncurkan ASKSKIN, terus mungkin tadi singgung ASKSKIN juga ada, terus program-program siswa-siswa miskin mungkin untuk dalam skala cepat, dan tapi pasti ada pengaruhnya, bagaimana Bapak bisa mengisolasinya. Yang kedua tadi mungkin dancing juga tentang regional pattern, urban karakteristik. Saya juga ingin tahu, siapa tahu Bapak juga bisa berdalam dengan resipient karakteristik seperti misalnya di rumah tangga tersebut ada lansia, penyandang cacat, disabilitas, anak-anak, single parents, dan sebagainya. Mungkin itu juga bisa memberikan pemahaman. Sebelumnya saya juga sangat terkritik ini dengan slide terakhir, sebelum slide terima kasih, dan ke depan UCT itu seperti apa, apakah inevitable, tidak terelakkan. Memang Pak, kondisi saat ini sekarang mungkin gejolaknya cenderung ke harga minyak, tapi tidak menutup kemungkinan juga ada terjadi gejolak harga pangan, mungkin juga gejolak yang lainnya itu. Tapi perlu kita pahami juga bahwa UCT ini adalah salah satu dari sekian banyak pilihan kebijakan. Mungkin kita bisa memperkuat kebijakan-kebijakan lainnya, atau kalau kita perlu susun di beberapa kali kesempatan sidang kabinet atau beberapa kali kesempatan rapat pemangku kepentingan, disebut-sebut bahwa kita harus menyusun crisis management protocol. Mungkin cash transfer is part of it, but we have to be sure with the mungkin semacam triggernya mungkin kita harus sepakati juga. Tapi kembali lagi Pak, itu kita perlu pahami bahwa UCT adalah salah satu dari sekian banyak polisi yang bisa kita ambil. Polisi lain mungkin ya kalau dihadapkan dengan subsidi mungkin kita bisa memilih apakah dengan cost benefit analysis kita bisa menimbang-nimbang risiko dan manfaatnya. Nah, terakhir saya ingin share informasi saja, kebetulan kami di Bappenas bersama dengan KMP2K didukung juga dengan Poverty Reduction Support Facility OSE, kita sedang kerjakan studi social impact of cash transfer programs in Indonesia, qualitative assessment. Ini mungkin agak lain dengan yang Bapak kerjakan atau studi-studi yang sebelumnya dikerjakan. Kalau yang Bapak paparkan ini lebih cenderung ke kuantitatif, ekonomi, microeconomics. Sementara yang kita kerjakan ini, sedang kerjakan ini, kita lebih cenderung mengambil perspektif selain menggunakan instrumen kualitatif, juga lebih ke sudut pandang antropolog. Background saya sendiri, saya ekonom, Pak. Tapi kita juga ingin tahu seberapa besar pengaruh UCT atau program cash transfer ini terhadap social cohesion, social fabric, trust with community, community empowerment. Mungkin memang tidak bisa kita sandingkan dengan studi-studi kuantitatif yang lainnya. Tapi paling tidak kita tahu gambarannya, bagaimana pengaruh program UCT, program cash transfer terhadap nilai-nilai lokal, nilai-nilai kegotong royongan yang seringkali disebut sebagai local wisdom, dan juga mungkin program-program perlindungan sosial lainnya yang terkandung di dalamnya nilai-nilai tersebut, misalnya program pemberdayaan masyarakat atau program bantuan tunai dengan syarat. Mungkin nanti Pak Tami bisa menambahkan, ketika ada UCT berjalan dengan CCT, PKH dengan BLT pada satu sama, bagaimana impact-nya, bagaimana pengaruh antar program dengan program-program yang lainnya. kita mungkin saya terlalu gini kalau bercerita tentang hipotesis maupun kita belum jalan Pak, itu baru kemarin selesai MOU. Mungkin ini akan sangat menarik, mungkin nanti saya akan usulkan ke Bu Vivi atasan saya, kalau memang sudah selesai mungkin kita bisa share ke forum yang selama ini. Saya rasa ini forum yang cukup legitimate untuk mendapat masukan dari Bapak Ibu sekalian. Mungkin itu dari saya, terima kasih.
Just to on the table. From the presentation, you see there's poverty transitions. You control the transfer per capita for the disbursements. Is it the total sum of the first disbursement and second disbursement, or is it the total of that? If it is it the possible? Is it did you have tried to put two different total sum on two different disbursements?
Therefore, speed, or speed, speedboat, yeah. And then a lot of the village, segment, they also deducted the number of the money that they are supposed to be distributed to the village. And then a lot of the villages who are very remote, they don't receive the money. They may be listed, but when we ask, they mentioned that my name is on the list, but we didn't receive the money because the Kecamatan and the trade assessment took that money. That is, should be reconsidered because we already know that 205 data is not quite sure, but we still use that one for they may give a poor implication or poor inclusion, especially for Banas, we are doing the same thing again in the future.
Thank you. Thank you, Pak. Yeah, I think your story is consistent with our findings here. Yeah. Because even in the top decile, the 10th decile, the 10th richest population, there are still some people who receive BLT. Yeah. So I think that's really a leakage way above the poverty line. So our hope is that maybe PPLS 2011 will be able to rectify this problem, and that's, I think, promising, but this has not been tested yet, so we still have to do that to the future. Now to Pak Rijal, regarding attrition, actually we try to be careful in this analysis, and we look at what happened with the entry terms. When we analyze them, the entry terms are more or less similar to the non-recipients. They are actually less poor than the recipients in general. So I think in that case, we were not too worried that about the entry terms because they are not coming from the mostly not from the VRP. With your suggestion to use poverty CPI, we actually also try to use the poverty line inflation, but not poverty CPI, but poverty line inflation, and we still get the same result. Yeah. So it's quite robust to various measures of inflation. Your suggestion to control for the difference in disbursement, I think that's quite interesting. We haven't done that yet. What we have done is we have a variable indicating whether the recipient, whether household is a recipient or not, then whether it has received the second disbursement or not. But to include the difference in the recipient, I think that that's an interesting suggestion. Thank you for that. For Pak Arendra, the first question is on how to isolate the impact of other programs. So in the data, in the Susenas data, they also have variables of other programs, other social programs, like Raskin, Pak Arendra also mentioned about the Raskin program, but also other social programs. So as much as it is available in Susenas, we try to control them. So it's part of the XH variable in our control variable. So hopefully that's already taken into account. Although maybe we have to acknowledge that there are maybe other programs we are not collected in Susenas, especially programs from non-government organizations, for example. Because in the areas there are maybe programs like NOPED to AFA, other NGOs, there are various programs. On the background of household, we actually tried several of them, like whether the household is female-headed and also old-age household members, things like that. But we haven't done the one on disability. I think it's not in Susenas, yeah. Disability data is not available in Susenas. That's in PPLS 2011, but that's not in the Susenas, so we cannot use that for the analysis here. I agree with you that UCT is just one policy option. That's why I put question mark on the last slide here, because we are not sure whether it will be implemented or not. I agree with you that we have to consider the benefit and cost of this program. I think one of the advantages of PLP is that the program is simple. It's easy to implement. I think that's one of the advantages of PLP compared to, for example, PKH, which is very complicated. It requires a lot of effort to monitor. With PLP, you just keep money, that's all. And thank you for the information about the social impact of cash transfer. I think that's interesting and also important, because and maybe it's not only for cash transfer, yeah, maybe for other program that's also important. How people view targeting, whether government handout should be targeted only to the poor or should be distributed to everybody, because after all, we are all citizens of the country. I think it is very important and interesting to know the view of the people on this matter, and it should influence government policy in the future. I think I have answered all the questions.
So we have another three questions.
Thank you. Just to request our mind. The 2000, my name is Sayuri from BPS. The 2005 PLP program actually did not design to reduce poverty, but rather more of helping poor people to prevent them from what we call become more difficult in life. If I'm not mistaken, we gave 100,000 rupiah per household per month by the time. It means 300,000 quarterly. And in 2005-2006, if I'm not mistaken also, the what we call the poverty line of around 225,000 rupiah per capita. It means roughly 9,000 rupiah per household. For the people around the poverty line, and we give them 100,000. It means just to for the purpose of for food security, not for education, not for health or other non-food consumption, really. So here, based on what I mentioned here, it's understandable if there is no impact of the UCT on education, on health, like what you mentioned. Because the purpose of the BLP, of the UCT, is not for education and for health. This is the first, I would like you to give comment on this. And the second, for us now, if we discuss about poverty, probably what is very challenging now is that we have to answer of why there is no significant impact of the almost what we call poverty alleviation program done by TNP2K, for example. There is cluster 1, Jamkesmas, UCT, CT, PKH, and cluster 2 for PNPM Mandiri, cluster 3 UMKM,
And all these things have no significant impact on reducing poverty. If we compare the data, poverty data, let's say March 2011 and September 2011, the decrease of the poverty incident is not significant. What I'm going to raise here is that we need, like our colleagues from Babenas, the study, probably anthropology-based study, social income-based study, because economic study, it seems, have no, what we call, cannot answer of why we fail to reduce poverty. Probably you have your opinion on this. Thank you, Pastor.
Kami berdua dengan Ibu Nurul dari Kantor Kementerian Sosial, Direktorat Jansos, di bawah Direktur Pak Edi Suwanto, Pak. Sebelum kemarin juga Pak Edi sudah ingin ke sini karena ingin melihat hasil dari penelitian UCT. Saya akan berbicara bahasa Indonesia, do you mind if I speak in bahasa?
No, but I know you, you speak English very well.
But this is Indonesia, right? Sorry for our English from others, yeah? Jadi begini, saya sebenarnya tidak bertanya. Jadi dengan kami berdua di UCT datang sendiri, sebenarnya kami ingin melihat Pak UCT unconditional cash transfer ini atau bantuan langsung telas, ya, kalau dalam bahasa Jawa ya, atau dalam bahasa Indonesia bantuan langsung tunai ini, karena kita itu kemarin hampir melakukan lagi UCT ini, ya, yang disebut dengan BLSM atau balsam bahasa kerennya. Udah dicetak itu kartunya di PT POS, ya. PT POS rugi 1 miliar, cetak. Ternyata nggak jadi naik, jadi dibagikan ya. Kita tuh mau lihat sampai sekarang, itu dampaknya dari UCT itu terhadap masyarakat yang kita berikan selama, kalau ini 1 tahun, 3 bulan itu, rencananya kan balsam itu 9 bulan. Diberikan 9 bulan. Nah, kalau dilihat dari hasil paparan ini, saya tadi agak kaget juga gitu, ada hasil yang menunjukkan bahwa UCT enable household to increase the generations of occupational health service sama education-nya ini ya, related to higher school dropout itu. Yang menjadi pertanyaan saya itu, kalau UCT dilihat dengan CCT, conditional cash transfer atau bahasa kerennya program keluarga harapan, kami dari pihak kementerian itu pasti melihat UCT ini kan sebagai kayak pelampung ya, ini ada orang dia udah mau tenggelam ini dikasih pelampung yang UCT. Nah, program cash transfer ini itu yang dilakukan oleh kementerian kami, semua program kecuali satu di direktoratnya Pak Edi Suwanto itu adalah jaminan sosial yang diberikan secara bersyarat. Ya, ini untuk berkaitan dengan tadi pertanyaan di halaman terakhir dari Bapak dengan model kedepannya itu seperti apa di sini. Jadi ini pola yang memang berbeda dari cash transfer 2 yaitu UCT dan CCT itu adalah yang satu untuk menyelamatkan, yang satu itu untuk meng-create yang lain. Meng-create yang lain adalah untuk melihat tadi ada nggak perubahan dalam bidang kesehatan dan pendidikan secara kualitas, quality maupun secara quantity. Karena berdasarkan hasil susnas itu majority orang-orang tidak bisa pergi ke sekolah itu bukan they don't want to go to school, but they don't have money. Jadi pemerintah kasih uang, tapi ini kasih uang, kamu pergi loh ke sekolah, baru kita berikan. Itu yang syaratnya. Beda dengan UCT, dibagi-bagi saja. Wah, kan begitu. Kami ingin satu, nanti pulang dari sini, kami ingin report kalau kondisi seperti ini, misalnya nanti naik BBM, UCT itu perlu diberlakukan lagi atau tidak. Balsam. Kami perlu ada sesuatu yang itu strength mark bahwa itu perlu atau tidak. TMP Bapak misalnya di tempatnya Pak Bambang ya, Pak Rizal ya, itu udah berpikir luar biasa untuk balsam ya. Tetapi harus ada satu dari lembaga luar itu yang terus memastikan potongan itu di mana. potongan dari tingkat mau keluarga miskin kah, dia mau rumah tangga sangat miskin kah yang dipakai. Sekarang aja kami dari PKH itu masih kebingungan untuk exit strategy yang sekarang dirubah lagi rencananya pemerintah, namanya transition strategy. Untuk memperhalus bahasa, potongannya itu di garis 5% atau 7% atau 10%. Bila 5% itu data yang kita pakai dulu, Susenas, yang exclusion dan inclusion error-nya itu gede.
PPS yang gede itu adalah PPS
yang
PPS
2005. Karena
PPS 2008
dan
sekarang lagi PPS 2011.
Ya, sekarang kami sudah menerapkan itu 2007. Kami makainya yang 2005 untuk yang 2007. Kemudian diperbaru lagi 2008. Sekarang lagi itu PPS 2011. Untuk menjawab pertanyaan Bapak, bagaimana nanti inclusion dan exclusion error-nya, nanti tunggu dulu TP2K. Baiknya by address sudah diberikan ke kami, sedang disisir sekarang. Nanti kami akan turun lagi melewati facilitator kami, berapa proses yang PPRS 2011 itu inclusion dan exclusion error-nya. Tahun sebelumnya itu CCD inclusion dan exclusion error-nya itu besar. Jadi target kita yang 500 ribu turun hanya 382. Itu pun open season tidak diberlakukan. Karena apa? Karena kami dituduh menggunakan data liar. Nah, untuk menjawab masalah UCT, jawab pertanyaan kami Pak pulang, apakah UCT masih diperlukan atau tidak? Karena program bantuan sosial itu ada 8 program. UCT itu adalah cash transfer, itu bagian dari JSLU, pajak, PKSA anak, kemudian PKH yang sekarang dikeluarkan dari UCT, dan yang satu adalah BLT. Tiga yang lain itu adalah Raskin yang programnya dari Bulog. Kemudian dulu ASKIN yang sekarang itu Jamkesmas yang dilakukan oleh kesehatan dan bantuan sosial miskin yang dilakukan oleh Kemendikbud. Jadi untuk targeting improvement pemerintah sudah berusaha melakukannya, memperbaikinya dengan PPLS 2008. Frequency of distribution ya UCT ini kita sekarang sedang mengarahkan ke CCT, tidak dengan monthly tetapi 4 kali pembayaran, jadi 3 bulan dibayar. Dan dipadatkan untuk pada saat bulan Juni. Nanti kita akan pembayaran tahap kedua. Bantuan tetapnya itu dipadatkan di sana agar kesulitan yang dalam subsidi itu bisa teratasi. Jadi anak itu tidak punya uang untuk mendaftarkan masuk sekolah, pemerintah dipadatkan di Juni pembayaran untuk UCT. Jadi kalau memang UCT itu diperlukan, itu untuk keadaan dan daerah seperti apa? Kalau tadi Bapak ya, dari BPS ya Pak, itu mengatakan bahwa PT POS itu daerahnya sulit terjangkau ya Pak ya. Itu betul sekali Pak, justru uang yang dikeluarkan oleh pemerintah untuk imbal jasanya yang tahun sekarang itu naik Pak dari PT POS. Terus setiap kali bayar kita harus mengeluarkan at least 8 miliar. Jadi pemerintah harus bayar gitu. Dan pembayarannya itu tidak ke komunitas, dia harus datang ke kantor, itu yang sulit. Datang ke kantor aja ongkosnya sudah 300 ribu untuk kalau yang daerah Indonesia Timur. Nah ini yang mungkin harus dipikirkan dari model UCT agar tidak terjadi UCT babak kedua. Saya rasa demikian ya. Terima kasih.
Saya sedikit aja Pak, saya mohon izin ya supaya nanti tidak lupa menanggapi sahabat saya dari Texas. Gini ya, karena tadi akan ada apa semacam verifikasi, kalau nggak salah kalimat HTT menghitung inclusion dan exclusion error dari PPLS 2011.
Bukan PPLS 2011. 2011 nanti akan kelihatan inclusion dan exclusion error yang sesudah kami turun ke lapangan.
Iya, jadi akan kelihatan nantinya ya. Ini saya akan ingin menggarisbawahi kalimat ini, gitu kan. Kelihatan dari mana? Jadi 2011 dengan proxy mean test yang kita lakukan berarti yang kita gunakan adalah pendekatan-pendekatan matematis statistik. Nah, batasan-batasan di mana orang exclusion dan inclusion pada domain statistik itu. Nah, kalau nanti ada suatu instansi ya, misalnya melakukan judgement melalui petugas lapangan, bisa saja ini sangat subjektif karena tidak berdasarkan suatu ukuran-ukuran standar. Jadi ini yang barangkali perlu kita sama-sama bicarakan lagi nanti teman-teman dari Depsos misalnya kalau mau melakukan itu. Kalau enggak, nanti akan ada kesan ini exclusion error, ini inclusion error, padahal tidak apple to apple untuk kita
kriteria sudah jelas, ibu hamil, anak balita, kemudian anak usia sekolah SD dan SMP. Itu yang kita teskan pada hasil dari BPS.
PKH sangat jelas, tetapi kalau yang ini barangkali perlu kita diskusikan lagi.
Oke, tapi saya sudah lihat formnya dari BPS yang untuk BPS 2011. Saya optimis bahwa data itu inclusion dan exclusion error-nya itu lebih dikit. Kecuali kalau petugas di lapangan. Ya Pak, petugas lapangan dia melakukan pendataan di bawah pohon jambu, contoh. Itu mungkin. Tapi
bukan itu poinnya. Artinya pekerjaan-pekerjaan yang sangat terukur jangan sampai dikonfrontasi dengan opini persepsi yang tidak terukur. Ini nggak bisa kita bandingkan, itu poin.
Tidak akan persulit aset nanti karena laporannya yang harus dikirim ke IAIN dulu cara aja dalam bahasa Inggris atau English it's not very clear about the UCT the geographical distribution I have the impression that it's mostly focused on Western Indonesia. Whereas, can you give me an idea about geographical distribution? Because, of course, in Eastern Indonesia, say in Ternate or Tidore or Halmahera, because of the cost of transportation, the cost of living are much higher, I would say. So, just a standard 100,000 rupiah would not be enough to cover the patient needs of population in all life. I think this doctor doesn't realize why many most of whom live in Western Indonesia. Because, after all, the western part of Indonesia generates about 80% of all GDP, whereas Eastern Indonesia only generates only 20% more. So, can you give me an idea about how the distribution of the BLT is spread all over Indonesia? And don't you say that for Eastern Indonesia, my cost of operation are much higher? And also one more thing, you say about per capita. They are also single person household, their household is say 10 members. So it's also racism.
Thank you, Pak Syairi. Thank you for your comments and also, comments that UCT is not for faculty, but to help the poor go through the difficulties because of the increase in the prices of goods because of the fuel price increase. I think that's from the program design point of view. But what we want to see here is that how the people actually use the money. For example, here we see in this table that how actually people use the money. They spend it on good things like the protein sources, vitamin sources, and everything. But also on other things like on alcohol, tobacco, and handphone uses. But that raises another issue that if we really want UCT, as Pak Seri said, is for food security, maybe we should consider different options rather than giving out cash. Maybe we should distribute something like food stamp, for example, that will be more directed toward the purpose of the program. So there are many things that we need to consider. And I think what happened in the field is not all bad or all good, it's a mix of everything. And what we try to do here is try to systemize this information so we can have a better judgment for the future. And that's actually what related to Ibu from Kemensos question. Although UCT is not meant for education ahead, for example, but we did found that household who receive UCT use help providers more than those that did not receive UCT, meaning that whether it is intended or not, but the impact on health is good, and also on education, because children who work now could afford to work less than before the house of the visiting UCT. UCT. So there are many ways people utilize the UCT money. Now, one of the critical question is on the targeting. So we know Pak Bambang has emphasized that PPLS, PHO5 is problematic, and we have seen that consistently here that it is problematic in terms of targeting. But the question whether PPLS 2011 will be able to rectify this problem, as you said, we should be optimistic, and we are also optimistic here because we, I mean Smeru here, also did a spot check on PPLS 2011 implementation. And the report is available in our website now in both Bahasa Indonesia and English. So if you want to know how the enumerators collect the PPLS 2011 data, you can see from that report. In fact, I think we, TNP2AK has invited us to give a presentation on that study very soon. So I think we will do that very soon. But I think so far we are also optimistic that 2011 PRS will be able to improve the targeting. But I think we have to be more realistic here that I think nowhere in the world we can have a 100% perfect targeting in social programs, especially in a country as large and diverse as Indonesia. I think in many countries people will be happy if the targeting indicators of 70% of correct targeting. That will be very good enough, I think. So what we mean by good targeting, we have to realistically set the target. It's not 100% for sure, that because that's impossible, because so many factors will affect the implementation of the data collection, and also there's a time lag from the data collection to the program implementation in which people situation could change during that time lag. 1 year is enough to change the poverty status of 30% of the population. So we have to take into account also that. Now to Pak Te. Pak Te, I think the geographic distribution of UCT recipient that mimics the distribution of the number of poor people. And the number of poor people, indeed, is contrasted in Java and Sumatra because there were where most people live. So most of UCT recipient also are in Java and in Sumatra, I think. That simply reflects the distribution of the poor people.
But the incidence of poverty in Papua is 40%.
Yeah, but 40% in Papua is only 40% of 3 million people. While in Java, 30% of 20% of poor people, 20% of 150 million people. So the number of poor people is much higher.
I know. But what I want to much of these UCTs is provided to people in East of Malaysia?
Okay. How much in terms of?
How many households or how many people?
We haven't calculated that yet, but I think it will reflect the same distribution as the number, as the possible.
The same.
It's the same. Yeah.
Distribution.
Yeah. The same as.
But then you don't have data about the number of households?
Yeah,
we just have not calculated it. Yeah. Yeah, we can calculate it if you need that. Yes.
No, because I just received a paper from Kim Sali, and it's a paper about Indonesia 2045, 100 years after independence. And he says if we are not careful, the NKRI will be no more. It's a warning which he sent to the president.
Okay, yeah. I think what Pak Emil meant is that the poverty rate in Eastern Indonesia is much higher than the poverty rate in Western Indonesia. That's true, but if we look at the number of poor people
I know.
In Western Indonesia, it's much higher than Eastern Indonesia. So I think it's a balance that we need to take into account many programs, or maybe there should be special program addressing Eastern Indonesia. Your comment on per capita transfer, I think that exactly part that's the point we try to make here, because a household with single member receive 100,000 per month, that's for him or her. But the household with 10 members is only 10,000 per people. That's why we suggest that we may need to consider this. Thank you. I think we have answers.
Is there a question? There are 5 minutes, maybe for two short questions.
Monthly expenditures, the conclusion that maybe it's better to have monthly, handouts. And the reason you gave was that a lot of people spent the 3-monthly handout immediately. And it sort of led me to reflect on, what's wrong with that? And a little bit further than that, I mean, why are we really interested in what the poor spend the money on? I can understand why people are very interested in getting to the poor. But then isn't it really up to them? I mean, isn't it rather paternalistic from a policy point of view, to suggest they should spend it on food. It's interesting from an academic point of view, but I wonder, you know, what are the debates about those issues? Thank you.
I think this relates more to policy impacts rather than methods, but I just want to also, this is also reflected from Patrick's question. I think some national programs, they are outdated. We don't need national programs anymore. We need specific programs for specific geographical areas. So that way that we can somewhat make modifications in the level of poverty, in the type of program, etc. And also, I'm thinking about the cost of these programs. Perhaps the UCT method is very high cost for places such as Papua or others. It's perhaps very effective or cost effective in Java, but this kind of cost-benefit analysis should be done also when you go and one plans for a program. So it's to be more cost effective in the delivery of this support.
Thank you, Ibu Mailani. I think that's a very valid point about the R-square. In our case, we have R-squares about 9-10%, but because OLS is not our model, it's just for comparisons, just the basic. Because OLS is biased in this model. But I think that's not a definite answer to your question. I have seen paper published in journals based on R squares lower than 0.4, for example. So basically, what people want to get is the storyline, how the model was developed, and what the parameters actually tell us. So people put more attention on the whether the parameter we get is biased or not, or whether it really tells us something. It's measures what we meant to measure. It's not representing something else like that. But I agree with your point that we should try to aim to have higher R-square. But in many cases, we are often restricted with. Because of the finite sample size. Actually, if we use very large data, like using census or critic, we can get R-square as much as 90%, simply by enlarging the sample size. But in most cases, we cannot answer most questions using very large database. Like that, because there's a trade-off between the numbers of variables and the numbers of observations that you can do. But I take your point. Pak Chris, this is also a very difficult question, and the debate is still going on, whether the government should act as the fathers of everybody who knows the best and they should direct household and how they spend the money. And I think the debate is still going on. Whether in the case of cash transfer, is conditional necessary or not? It's still a big question. And again, I think that the answer is not clear-cut yes or no, because for example, from this table, we can see that it's a myth. Yeah? People use the BLT money for good things, by buying fish, buying meat, at least from the public, public policy point of view, it's bad because it has a negative externality.
Okay.
Obviously, no problem. Okay. Spend money on good things, but yeah, I think this is a philosophical equation.
Yeah. Because it's an adjustment to a price effect, right? This is different from the other programs that are directed to education or directed to health. We're saying there's an increase in prices, you have a immediate consumption effect. We're also going to direct you as to how you respond to that increase in prices. That seems to me a bit too paternalistic.
Yeah. I know some people who argue that just give the money to the poor. The poor will use the money wisely according to their base on interest, and they will not squander the money. But I think empirical evidence is not 100% working there. It's a myth. I think the same with everybody here. If our children ask for money, just give me the money. Don't ask how I'm going to use the money. I think most parents will refuse to do that. Yeah. Most parents will ask how I'm going to use the money. What is the money for? I think most parents will do that. But again,
no, I don't have money.
That's right.
I think that's ideal if the programs can be tailored specifically for each region. But I think, unfortunately, so far, our evidence shows that it has not always worked as we want. The latest example is the PMPM program. I think a couple of years ago, PMPM was decentralized to the region, but this year they have to take it back to the center because most of the regional government simply doesn't have the capacity to manage and implement the program. Same thing with BOS. Remember, when the BOS was decentralized to the Kabupaten Kota government, so many schools did not receive the money. 3 months, 6 months, even after 1 year. But the government now take it back and put it at the province level. Now the same thing going on with Puskesmas. Now many Puskesmas complain they have not received the money after what now? Now it's the end of May. Because the government has decentralized the Puskesmas fund to the district government. So I think in the end, the government will have to take it back again. But I think one lesson from this is maybe that when the government is decentralized, it should not be uniform. They should look at the capacity of its regional government. When a regional government has the capacity to implement programs, okay, you can do this. I will give program to you and you run the program. But for other regional government, which fails to do that, then you pay. So it's an asymmetric decentralization. It's not uniform decentralization. Same thing with the cost of the program. Yeah, I think that also exactly the same. I think that's all. Yeah.
I think the time is up, so we have to close.